standing by.
Morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari on this glorious winter's morning out here in the African bush. We are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park of South Africa. My name is Jamie and I'm back from leave and thrilled to be back from leave and reunited once again with Brian, who is on camera with me this morning. We have a special treat planned for you because I believe the fantastic Steph is out on a vehicle, lo and behold, and Mr. Hendry is on foot. We have all kinds of wonderful things planned for you. You can see we're all wrapped up like we're heading off into sort of sub-Arctic temperature conditions. That's because we're South African, and as South Africans we're not quite built to deal with the cold. Even though it's only around 11 degrees this morning, which is 51 odd Fahrenheit, not too chilly at all, it still feels pretty cold when you're sitting here on the vehicle. Now don't forget that you can ask questions, and you can do that on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And what that means is that it's essentially a fantastically interactive safari experience, almost like you're on the back of the vehicle with us. If you were on the back of the vehicle, you would get to see how Brian is dressed this morning. He is he's mostly just eyes and hands. That's all I can see of Brian. Just one tall shape covered in many, many layers. That being said, he does of course have to bear the brunt of the wind chill factor that flows over the top of the vehicle. Right, so plan for this morning. We've come through to where Karula was last seen with her cubs. Apparently she had a Nyala kill not too far from where I am now. James said to me that he thought that she'd be gone by this morning just because the Nyala that she managed to catch was very small, so it was pretty much all gone by the end of yesterday's sunset safari. And I think I'm going to take his word for it, because while I'm driving along here, all I'm seeing is not leopard tracks, but hyena tracks wandering through. So the hyenas have come to pay Karula's kill, at least, a visit. Let's just double check along here. He's in here. Brian's just telling me exactly where the kill was. I just want to double check. Yeah, the hyenas have definitely been through. Was to be expected. Just trying to see where the off-road tracks have gone. Maybe we can investigate. Let's go further forward. So she picked a spot right in the drainage line around a road called Ingwe Alley. Ingwe, of course, being the word for leopard in the local language. Here we go, there's vehicle tracks coming in here. And we're going to go check. We're going to see if Karula's sticked around is definitely not the past tense of stick, stuck around Juma, or if she's moved off further south. So while we investigate the site of the kill, let's head across to Steph, find out what his plans are for the morning.
Good morning. Good morning to everybody. And you've caught me and cameraman on the job today is David. And we are on our way to Cheetah Plains for a bit of an extraordinary adventure. I have never been to Cheetah Plains in terms of game driving before, and so you're going to be coming with me today on one of these let's turn left, let's turn right expeditions that generally are actually quite productive for me, to be quite honest. When things are at their most chaotic or tend to be at their unplanned, for instance, I seem to have luck like that. That is where my luck lies. Unlike our dear friend Brent Leo Smith, who works very hard at producing his own luck, I have to survive on the universe's good graces. But we've just checked Treehouse. We've been having a look around this morning. We've managed to go past Treehouse Dam already. Not too much sign over there. There's some old lion tracks that come into this area. Very fresh hippopotamus tracks. I don't think we're going to catch them, but quite fresh hippopotamus tracks. And now we've just got a herd of impala that is standing in this early morning dawn with their fur raised up. And you can see this young male here. Let's see if we can get a little bit closer to him, and I'll show you what I mean by fur raised up. You'll notice that they're quite fuzzy at this time of the day. There we go. No, no, don't go anywhere. Why are you doing that? So let's see if we can reverse a little bit. There you can see where they get their characteristic local Afrikaans name of red buck from, is that red basically stripe across their back, or that red mantle that they have. And that's their undercoat that's shining through like that. Just like we do when we cold our hair. Each hair that we have is on an erectile muscle, and when we cold, our bodies contract that muscle and raise the hair up. And what that effectively does is it slows air movement down across the body, trapping a layer of air that is then warmed by your body between the hairs, keeping you a little bit warmer. The next step would be to start shivering. That's an involuntary muscular action to generate some heat in your muscles. And then basically what your body does is starts to shut down extremities. Basically starts to get blood coming from all your toes and your fingers and your nose and your ears, and starts to force it into your core. We don't get that cold in South Africa. There are very, very few places in South Africa that you could get hypothermia or frostbite. Actually, I lie. There are a few places that are in South Africa where you could do that. But from our surface area, we're actually semi-arid, very warm. It's much more likely in South Africa to get dehydration and heat exhaustion than it is to get hypothermia and frostbite. Is this impala going again? Not looking too nervous, I'll be honest with you. Although he seems to be quite frantic. That's not anything, but he just felt like he was a little bit alone. Impala don't like to be alone for too long. Let's go forward a little bit and have a look at this male, whatever he's up to, and see the herd that he's just joined now. So yeah, you'll see that as the day starts warming up, just in a little bit of time, that reddish color, that brilliant red that you saw, will disappear underneath a more tanny coat as the hair starts to lay flat again. Now this is a mixed herd of impala. There's some females and some males, and that hasn't been the case for the last couple of months. For those who watch the show quite often, you would have noticed that in May, we had the rut, and their male impala were separate. You had a dominant ram, and he was with the females, and then the rest of the impala, all the young males, were grouped together in these bachelor herds. Now they've all joined forces again, and that's because from the rut, which happened in the beginning of May this year, basically there's been a decrease in testosterone levels in these impala, and now they're not as aggressive anymore, and so they're tolerating these herds forming out of both males and females again. And that's a good thing. More eyes and more ears mean that there's a greater chance of seeing a predator. And so that's just Mother Nature's way. She has these dips and troughs in testosterone with these males. And when it's not needed for the two herds to be separated, the males from the females, then they join forces together and look after the newly pregnant females. And they will be pregnant for about, I think, gee whiz, it's like level one guarding over here coming back to me again with trying to guess exactly how long impalas are pregnant for, but it's 220 days. So they'll be pregnant for 220 days, and we can expect the first lambs to be dropped here at the end of October, somewhere around November, with the majority of them again in December. Joey, all the way from Australia, I suppose it's a good afternoon to you in that part of the world. And you've asked how close I can get to impala in a vehicle. Joey, you can get so close to them that they will basically be brushing the sides of the car. Not this particular herd, but herds that are associated with camps. Quite often these camps and lodges in this particular area have these open areas that are around the camp that are denuded of trees, and it's to give guests in the camp a nice view over the plains, so to say. And quite often impalas frequent these plains, and those impalas become very relaxed with people and with cars. And we find often that those impala, literally you could walk between them, not quite touch them, but they get so used to people and cars that right up to the vehicles, right up to you, even on foot. Let's get into a nice place to see if we can watch the sunrise. Now the conundrum that I'm facing at the moment is, do I follow up on those what to me look like old lion tracks at Treehouse Dam, or do we carry on going for our adventure at Cheetah Plains? The choices that I'm faced with on a morning like this. Do we follow lion or do we go on an adventure? Kirsten says she votes Cheetah Plains, only because we don't know what's going on there as well. Right, let's find a nice place here through the trees where we can watch the sun come up. And that'll give us a chance to switch the car off and listen to the bush around us, which is very important. It's actually how I find most of the animals that I show you is through my ears, or ear in this case, because my one ear is otherwise occupied with final control. Let's have a look down there. And so while we're enjoying this sunrise together, and I'm busy warbling on at anything that comes to mind, I'm also busy listening for alarm calls. There's a sinking mass of air that has gradually been coming down and cooling down and therefore sinking throughout the evening. And what this does is this creates this very stable column of air just close to the Earth's surface. And this animals and birds have used for centuries to talk to one another over large distances. So it's a good time to hear for roaring, both leopard and lion roar. And it's also a very good time to hear the alarm calls of animals. Here you're looking through the tangled mass of a marula tree in the foreground, and the horizon, which is actually quite far, it's probably about a mile or two away, right to the east. Now we've just had our winter solstice on the 21st of June. It was the longest night of our winter, or our dry season. I must say, it's been very pleasant to be sleeping where we are in these cooler temperatures and with these long nights. Most of us sit around the fire at night time not knowing what to do with ourselves before we go to bed. But it has been a lovely balance to the chaos nature that is summer. And we all feel it. People, animals, and in anticipation of the season to come, everything's taking these last few weeks of the dry season to just rest and relax. Well, we are probably going to have to move for this car that's in front of us. And while we do so, I think it would be a good time to send you over to Jamie, who's got an update for you.
While Steph moves out of the way of another vehicle, we have, I think, found Karula's cubs track. Not Karula's tracks, just her cubs. But they're fresh enough that I think they've disappeared off towards one of her favorite areas, which is Treehouse Dam. Now let's keep our eyes peeled, because I think with full bellies, she'll have moved her cubs away from the kill site so that they don't attract the attention of any marauding hyenas. But at the same time, with full bellies, I don't think she's going to have moved them too far away. Let's just do a quick loop around. I'm so excited to see them again. I may be too excited. I always feel like Murphy's Law is going to deny me the chance to see them, just because I really want to see how big they've grown. I've seen the screenshots, of course, and they are looking, compared to when we first saw them, absolutely enormous, but still incredibly cute, very fluffy. And there's not much that is cuter than a leopard cub. I know James says that lion cubs are the cutest. What do you think, Brian? Lion or leopard?
I'm on the fence.
You're on the fence, okay. Fair enough. Depends on what we're seeing on the day.
Yeah.
That's true. That is true. Line, yeah, that is true. Lion cubs are that constant sort of ow, ow sound that they call to each other and to their mothers is also incredibly appealing. I don't know, okay, we'll reserve judgment for now and let's find both today. Let's do both. Let's go shoot high, aim high. All right, now these tracks have gone completely off the road. Now while we investigate and see if we can't concentrate on tracking down Karula and her cubs, let's find out what Mr. Hendry has planned.
Good afternoon. No, good morning, everybody. That's the second time in a row I've managed to make a mess like that. Good morning and welcome to the Bushwalk. It's marvellous to be on foot again. My name is James Hendry. Viam is on camera. Hello, Viam. That's Viam's really lengthy thumb. For some, it's about the same length as his bottom leg. Now, also with us today, Herbert, who is on security detail. He'll be wandering about here, tracking things and finding the finding the things of the bush that are relevant to the Shangaan culture of this area, and I think that's quite an important thing for us to be looking at. Right, it's 11 degrees Celsius apparently. It feels a little warmer than that, but it's windy. There's a strong northwesterly breeze coming from behind me, and we're going to just sort of invest. I'm not sure what we're going to do today. That's the joy of walking out here. We're going to see about the small things, and if we can help Jamie with tracking those little cubbies, then that's what we'll do. She's basically down there where I'm pointing now with my rather impressive stick, and we're going to walk that way and see if we don't intersect with the tracks. And by that way, I mean we're going to move that way. Right, on we go. Now, of course, being on foot is a vastly different experience from being in the vehicle, and it is indeed very pleasant to be walking again, to be in touch, as it were, with nature in far sort of closer contact. Now, let us first take a look at this rather large tree. It's called a gardenia. It's called a Transvaal gardenia. I think that's what they call it. Gardenia falkensii, anyway, that's the botanical name. And it has the most delightful smelling flower of all the flowers out here. It smells like sweet jasmine, only for 2 or 3 days of the year. But it is one of the last remaining trees to have leaves on it. And what's interesting, if you look around here, that's VMP being artistic this morning. If you look around here, you'll see that all the lower leaves have been browsed off. See that? They've all been browsed off. And clearly the top part of the tree has hardly been touched. Now that means that the giraffe and the elephants are not particularly partial to this, and it'll be interesting to see as the season progresses whether they become interested or not. I would also suggest that it isn't even the impala that are eating these. This looks to me like it's been fed on by a duiker and something very small. I mean, yeah, an impala will eat, it could be impala as well. They reach up to round about this height. That's quite an interesting browse line. Here, everywhere you stop, you see, you find hundreds of different things. Is the burrow, I think. I would say that's a bushveld gerbil, or it's an excavation by a bushveld gerbil. And you know what they found here, VMP? Whatever it was that excavated this, quite possibly a bushveld gerbil, they found themselves a dung beetle ball. Now, inside this dung beetle ball, there would have been an egg, and the egg may well have hatched already, and the grub then would have been feeding on the dung. In fact, I think this is probably the dung inside here. And out of it, once it's pupated, when the next rains come, will emerge a very new dung beetle. Viam's just getting himself caught on top there. Yeah, I can't see anything in here. Let me try and break it with my stick. It was very successful. Did you see that, Viam?
No, I was getting out of the tree.
He says he's getting out of the tree. Yeah, anyway, this is still intact. This is a marula. This is a marula seed. It is unrelated to this. So that's what would have happened here. There's also evidence of, in fact, so maybe this isn't a, this might not be a bushveld gerbil. There's evidence here of millipedes. Now, millipedes, we know, are eaten extensively by burrowing scorpions. And the burrowing scorpion, well, this will be a very substantial burrowing scorpion if this is where he lives. But that is perhaps what he is. He can cope with the cyanide in the millipede's body somehow, I don't know how. And so maybe that's what it is, rather than a bushveld gerbil, which would be rather more, I suppose, a seed eater than it would a grub and millipede eater. Very nice. Right. There's the sun over there. Do you see it, Viam? It's that big yellow thing over there. And also sitting, gazing into the golden rays and warming his face, Mr. Stefan Winterbur.
I'm actually warming my face. James isn't actually quite far wrong from that. Only thing is, is I can't even stare at the sun anymore. You're looking at the sun there through a filter or two. And because we've had such windless days the last couple of days, we actually have got no dust in the atmosphere, and it's actually almost too bright to have a look at, which is actually phenomenal. But one thing about this sun of ours, you know, it is our closest star. It is about 8.3 light minutes away, whereas the next closest star is 4.3 light years away. And that is a vast, vast difference. So we're 8.3 light minutes away from our sun. And I've just read the most interesting fact that the escape velocity, which means a particle of matter would need to be traveling at this particular speed to escape the gravity of our sun, needs to be traveling at 620 kilometers per second to escape the gravity of our sun. Now that pretty means, let's turn that into miles for you, it's divided by 1.6, and my mathematics is not that good. So you can take 620 and divide it by 1.6 would be the miles per second that a particle of matter needs to basically be traveling at to escape the sun. Now, although that doesn't interest many people, for me, that is quite an interesting thing. And we haven't even got a very big sun. Our sun isn't particularly hot. It isn't particularly big. It doesn't have any unique features, apart from the fact that it seems to be the only planet that we, or the only star that we know of that has a planet with liquid water on it and bearing life in all its profusion. So it is a unique star in that sense. Going to be a hot day today, which is good. We're moving fast towards our spring, which happens on the 1st of September. And after spring, around about November, we're going to have our summer. And we're expecting here the knobthorns to start flowering here somewhere around about the 10th to the 20th of August. We'll start getting the first flowers in the bush. But on that note, and while we cross this little drainage line in front of us with signal breakups, Jamie has got an update for you.
I do indeed have an update for you, and the update comes right as Steph sent you back across onto Wendy, which is of course our trusty vehicle that is creaking a little bit like she has some serious wheel pain. There we go. So that's what we are. That's exactly what we've been looking for, right next to Treehouse Dam, exactly where we expected to find them. And let me just hop out, because I want to investigate and see whether or not she has her cubs with her, or if it's just Karula, the female leopard that we've been searching for. Oh, an answer is almost apparent. Let me just see. Can you see these ones, Brian? Over here. Cool, thank you. So here's Karula's tracks over here. This is her front foot with its four toes. And here's her back foot, slightly narrower, slightly longer. And what we're looking for at this point is little miniature leopard tracks as well, which I don't see at the moment. I've got civet tracks wandering about. Oh, yeah, there they are. I think the way that I've put Brian is going to make life very difficult, but there are little tiny leopard feet walking up along with her. And in fact, now that I look more carefully, it tells a whole story here, because they've been crisscrossing around mom. You've seen the way that the leopard cubs move, the way that they follow their mother. They dash to one side and then they come back and they kind of sort of zigzag around her legs, and that's what they've been doing. They've been crisscrossing. Okay, and generally when they follow this route, and these tracks are not fresh. The wind's been blowing all night, and their outline, if you compare it to, which ones were we looking at? These ones. Compare the outline of those tracks to, can you see that track there, Brian, that I've made? Thank you. Compare that to the crispness of my shoe print. Now we know I've just made that. These tracks are not fresh, but the wind is blowing, which always ages tracks a lot quicker than they might otherwise. Okay, let's go see if she's still on the property. Usually when she follows this road, I dread to say, means she's going south towards Little Gowrie. But let's just check. So Little Gowrie is south of our traverse area, away from where we can follow up on her. But that's okay. If she's left our boundary for now, we can always look forward to her return, and we can go look for the hyena den. A lovely question from Michael, because of course if these tracks don't cross out, let's say they go into this block, then we'll have to go wandering about on foot to see whether or not we can find them. Now Michael's raised an interesting point, which is how will the cubs react to us on foot? Would they run away, or would they watch Karula's reaction in order to gauge how they should react? Michael, it's a really interesting one. Ooh. Tiny little feet walking along Treehouse Road. Yes, the animals, the baby animals, will react and watch the way that their mothers respond to something. They take their cues from the mother itself. However, seeing people on foot, I think the cubs are slowly getting used to. They've been tracked multiple times on foot before, whether it's by us or by other guides further off to the south. So they'll be getting used to it. I think they'll still run away a little bit. Sorry, Michael, I'll get back to you in a second. I'm just having a look at how crisp these tracks are. Oh, this is such a lovely example. I'm going to try to show you, because we get a chance to see how big these feet are as well. And I can show you what I mean about the cubs crisscrossing around her. Oh, this is so cute. Okay. Sorry, Michael, be back responding to you in 1 second. But just have a look here. You've got these little stream of baby tracks racing back towards where Mom has walked through. There you can see where they collided with Mom. Backwards and forwards. Little cub prints absolutely everywhere. Okay, please, little cubs, still be here. You can almost imagine, you can picture the scene that happened here. There's just leopard tracks everywhere, bouncing backwards and forwards. And of course, they're at that age now where they're much more playful, a little bit braver, a little bit more confident in their abilities. Okay. Let's go and follow up, see if we can't. It's this funny thing, and I'm not the only guide that's ever felt this, but when you see tracks like this, you actually really don't want to drive over them. There's something so perfect about the evidence that an animal's left behind. It's almost like tearing up a newspaper with the day's news. It's a bizarre thought, I know, it's completely irrational, but it's just the way I feel. I hate driving over them. I like leaving them for somebody else to see as well, because they tell you such a beautiful story. Okay, we'll duck around them. Just close my eyes and drive. No, don't close your eyes, you're looking for leopards. Michael, I think they'll run away a little bit. They'll watch the way that Karula reacts, and it'll get to the point where they will be like Sindile was. So Sindile, when he was Shadow's cub, when he was sort of 7-8 months old, when I first started working at Wild Earth, it was incredible. He was so beautifully relaxed on foot, even more so actually than his mum. Shadow had a tendency, she hasn't done it for a long time to me at least, but that's because I haven't seen her in a while, but Shadow had a tendency when you walked up to her to go brrrr, something I think Brian experienced at one point. Yeah, she'd come charging out with stiff legs and bristling fur, but Sindile on the other hand was absolutely magical. He was so relaxed, you could sit 20 meters, not that we did often, but you could sit 20 meters from him and just enjoy his company. And I think Karula's cubs will get to that point. And while we investigate, I think the wondrous and terribly entertaining James has found himself on a very popular spot at Wild Earth.
Hello everybody, we're here at the Fireside Chat, and James Richard, you reminded me, and well done for remembering that. We're here at the buffalo skull that we had in our tent, and in it, of course, we found two gecko eggs. Now, in the interim, while we've been away, the eggs are still there, but you can only just sort of see them. So Vian will now stick his camera up the cavity here, and you'll be able to see where the egg is. So is my hand in the way? There we are. You will be able to see it, I promise everybody. Oh dear, Vim. What's going on there? You practiced this 5 or 6 times.
Yeah.
Okay, now that white bit there is the egg. White bit just to the left of that sort of a ridge of bone, there's an egg there. So there is at least one gecko egg left inside the cranium of this buffalo, which I think is rather splendid. It looks a bit muddy in there because a whole lot of the termite mound that had been built up the side of the tree that I left this against seems to have fallen down into the skull. So that should provide a little bit of a sort of covering, I suppose, for the little gecko eggs. We don't know when or if they're going to hatch. They may or may not hatch. I think it's quite an odd time for a gecko to have laid her eggs in the middle of winter. Normally, apparently, it's in the summertime, and quite interestingly for a reptile, they only lay 2 eggs or so, which is not many eggs at all. All right, let's go this way. We're going to head down vaguely into the area where Jamie is with those tracks. We all think that she's probably crossed south, but let's go down there. We'll see if we can give her a hand. In the meantime, I'm sure there'll be lots of other things for us to look at. Over in the distance, we can hear a whole lot of elephants shouting. And while we are just seeing if we... I don't think we're going to see them. They're quite a long way west of where we are now. Mike in Florida, you want me to try and find you a scorpion or an arachnid? Now, I'm not the eyes of Steph, but I will certainly do my best to find you a scorpion or another kind of arachnid. Very few and far between are the spiders and things at this stage. Right, let's carry on here. The elephants are all shouting off towards the west. I've lost my stick. I knew I'd lose it. I think I've probably dropped it by the fireside. I'm just looking. Herbert's gone, very kindly gone to fetch it for me. Thank you, Herbert. Baba Herbert. Gary, you want to know why I need a stick? Well, I need a stick for 2 reasons. The first is to bash Viam on the head when he's not behaving himself. The second is to, when a buffalo charges, what you do is, as you time it just right, you take a swing like that, and if you clock it just behind the top of the head, you stun it, and it sits down, and then it doesn't kill you. That's why I need a stick. That is, of course, utter nonsense. I carry a stick purely after... You know what, the 2 reasons I carry the stick. First is because I quite enjoy pointing at things with it. The second is that the last time I didn't have a stick, I was shown a clip of myself pointing out some stuff on a termite mound, and my left hand sat at this very strange angle. And I was described as a sort of Tyrannosaurus rex, an effeminate or velociraptor. And so I decided that I would from henceforth always carry a stick when I was on foot. Right. I'm not sure if you've been introduced to Herbert properly this morning. This is Herbert. Herbert lives very close by. He is a superb tracker. He's a superb guide. And he is basically on security detail helping us to just spot things. Because, you know, when we're on foot like this, it is very important that we keep very aware of what's going on around us. And while certainly we've done many, many walks with just the cameraman and the presenter, it's much safer now because I can just concentrate on the lens and VM can concentrate on filming and that sort of thing. And we know that Herbert's got his eyes out in the bush looking all the time for anything, well, that might be entertaining or that could be a potential threat. So that is the plan from here. (laughs) Kyle, I'm going to assume that your question is slightly facetious. You're saying, do I have any plans to climb a tree? Kyle, I don't, but if I find a candidate for tree climbing, yes, I will certainly climb it. I do need to sort of redeem myself after my last attempt, which resulted in a slightly odd fall from the top of a tree. I didn't fall onto the ground. I therefore do not say that I fell out of the tree, but more sort of within the tree. So I might try and climb a tree. We'll see if we can find a good candidate. I did find one yesterday while we were on drive. It was a marula tree that had a whole lot of moisture sort of in the branches, which was very strange indeed. Not sure why it was like that or where that moisture came from. Now, one of the nice things about the winter, if you look down through there, we can see through the bush, and those elephants are wandering about somewhere over there. And in summertime, of course, that would be far, far too thick for us to be able to see anything. So it's quite nice in wintertime to be able to see a little bit better. Right, let's head across to Jamie, get an update from her while Steph heads towards Cheetah Plains, and hopefully we'll have something interesting the next time we see you.
Well, as we cruise along incredibly slowly, checking the southern boundary, my update is to tell you something that happened behind the scenes. Obviously, I've been on leave, and I missed out on all of the shenanigans that were occurring, but thanks to our loyal viewers, I did get to watch the video of James falling out of the tree. I mentioned it casually in conversation last night, to which he replied, "I'll have you know I didn't fall out of the tree. What happened? The branch snapped, and I controlled my descent most gracefully." Wasn't graceful at all. There was nothing graceful about it. The branch snapped. I can only imagine how his shoulder must have felt after that, because it took the full brunt of his weight. Oof, must have pulled terribly. But it was hilarious to watch. So thank you for those of you who put up the video. Between Brent and James falling out of trees, they've given us a very clear indication that perhaps as a species, we are no longer have the climbing skills that our ancestors used to have. On a completely different tack, I believe that Mr. Winterboer has been exploring Cheetah Plains, reacquainting himself. Let's go and see what feathered creature he's found.
Yes, and we are at Cheetah Plains, and we've just got one of my most favorite birds, the glossy starling, the greater blue-eared glossy starling. Getting its name from that cheek pad that you see just below its ear. Now, it's quite difficult for us to, they're quite fast-moving birds, but just have a look at those colors, that brilliantly orange eye. There we go, standing in the sun for a second to try and get you. See if I can move my car slightly. There you go. An insectivorous bird. So running around on the ground, looking for titbits, insects, ants, and termites, basically. Let's see if we can go backwards a little bit. All right. Just all of David's skill at, no. Nevertheless, there will be others. We are finally in Cheetah Plains, and what I can say is that we are surrounded by a bird party. That wasn't just the glossy star. Oh, did we blow that one? All right. Fast-moving birds. All right. And from the birds that eat worms to the actual worm, James has found some.
It is indeed some kind of a worm. Look over here. And worm, of course, is not actually a biological term. This sort of worm is actually an insect grub. And it's, I don't know what it is, but you can see its digestive system. You can see that black bit going down through the middle of it. It's quite interesting. And Herbert says it's called bongo in Shangan. And apparently they're very delicious to eat. Viam and I have declined the offer to eat them, and when I suggested to Herbert that he might like to eat it, he recoiled in horror and ran away. So I think it's probably a more desperation diet than a delicacy. I don't know what kind of grub it is. So it's a larva. If you look carefully, I know that's a bit nasty of me to turn him over, but you can see maybe that he's only got six legs. So he's definitely an insect, and that means he will probably become a beetle of some kind. He could easily become a ground beetle. I'm going to suggest that that's probably what he is. Look at him burrowing under the ground there. Then there was a centipede here as well, but he seems to have escaped. You know, he's going to be buried completely. We'll let him bury himself. While we do that, a whole lot of termites here as well. And there's a big soldier. And these termites belong to a mound that Viam is just sitting behind. And they've come out of the mound and they're foraging and eating away at this piece of marula tree that's fallen out of its... Well, it's fallen out of the tree, unsurprisingly, or been pulled down by elephants. And it's now being eaten by the termites. And they've even left a little cask over here that I'm going to open up. There we are. And they've half sort of built a mound under the ground as well. And there we have the digging. Look, he's almost buried himself completely there. Isn't that amazing? I think that's so very clever. Don't know what he eats, don't know what species of beetle he is, but probably a ground beetle, perhaps. Let's just have a look over here. What is this? This looks like a fungus, everyone. There are lots and lots of different kinds of fungi that grow all over the wood here. And interestingly, I mean, everything here is dry, you know, so there's not much moisture. And yet still, fungus, which we know likes moist environments, manages to thrive here. Okay. Oof, those elephants are very angry. They're shouting. You can't hear them. They're going... Viam, would you like to do an impression? There we go. That's exactly what they sound like. I'm going to flip this back over, just simply because it's much, you know, we've disturbed what isn't essentially a miniature ecosystem here. And then a question from Croach Renee. You want to know how big the termites are? The termites there, the big soldier termite is about... half an inch. So he's about half an inch long, and the little ones no more than sort of 3 or 4 millimeters long, which is very small. Right, let's wander off down this way. We're still looking for spider and scorpion, and we might be lucky. Of course, all the crab spiders that are specially designed to live on the flowers out here are pretty much dead for the season. They'll have laid their eggs, and the little egg sacs will be hanging in various plants, waiting for better climate for them. Okay, let's go and find out from Jamie how her Karula hunting is going. We'll continue down here.
Well, we have really good news, I hope. And the really good news is that during our Karula search, rather, I think I've established that she hasn't crossed to the south of us, at least from where her tracks were last seen, which is really good news because chances are that means she's still somewhere here on Juma. All that means, though, is that we just have to now figure out exactly where she is and where she's hidden those little babies of hers. Which might mean going for a little bit of a stroll. I just want to check this one. This is the last place I want to check, which is along this road, Shabam Road. And interestingly enough, Shabam, spelt with an X, in the local languages, the X sound is a sh sound. Now this is Shabam Road, and she loves it. Treehouse Road, Shabam Road, Philemon's Cutline, all sort of favorite paths of Karula. So I want to check that she hasn't popped out here. If she hasn't popped out here, then it's sort of safe to assume that she's in the block there somewhere with those cubs. Exciting times. The bush is actually now getting harder and harder to spot leopards in. Now, speaking about tracking on foot and searching for leopards in this brown bush, and so perfectly geared towards the camouflage, a warm welcome to Lynn and good morning. Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. You wanted to know what would be the most protective towards their babies. And the answer very much is a lion. A lioness that is looking after young ones, and I've done it once, I've done it twice, where I've stumbled in upon lionesses with very young cubs totally accidentally. And where I used to work, there were very thick, dense river systems, beautiful, but also quite scary to walk in. And there is nothing like a protective lioness. And a leopard's a bit smaller. A leopardess is used to having to run away from things. A lioness stands her ground more so than any other lion encounters. She gives a low growl that speaks to one of our most sort of basic and atavistic instincts within us. It's a very scary sound, and she's usually very determined in telling you to go away, and it, quite often with sort of brief but very fast rushes forward with her teeth bared and making a sound that sounds roughly like a motorbike. Though without question, a lioness is one of the most protective, or definitely the most protective of her cubs. Hyenas will run away, the hyena cubs will run to their den, that's why they have those den sites. And leopards generally, they might charge you depending on how close you've got to them, and it's important again to know the leopard and to never underestimate them, because I've said the chances are they'll move away from you. Karula, from what I've experienced and from what other guides have experienced, she's actually wonderful on foot. She's beautifully relaxed, even when the cubs have been quite small and they've been stumbled upon by mistake. She's always taken it in her stride, as only the Queen of Juma can, because at 12 years old, she's seen it all. She's learned all about what people on foot means and doesn't bother her in the slightest. I'm not sure I would feel quite so comfortable going to look for the Nkuhuma lioness, for example, with brand new cubs. Alright, she hasn't popped out here either, which is good news. It means we've narrowed down pretty much exactly where she might be. So I'm going to head back to